Sir, there is a gift arranged for the chief guest. That will come with the bouquet or another time, separately.
as a forum for the finance ministers and central bank governors to discuss global economic and financial issues. It was upgraded to the level of heads of state or government in the wake of the global economic and financial crisis of 2007. And in 2000, the premier forum for international economic cooperation. Staff and students, we welcome each and every one of you to G20 University Connect, Engaging Young Minds. In order to be able to commence the program, may I request Mr. Ali Syed, let us move forward with the program by viewing the video clip on the theme of Indian Presidency 2023, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, One Earth, One Family, One Future.
India, home to 1.3 billion people, is a confluence of religions, traditions and customs. A thriving global center of technology and the world's largest democracy. As one of the oldest civilizations in the world with a rich cultural heritage and diversity, and as the fifth largest economy in the world, India is proud to assume the presidency of G20. As the country blooms into a new era, we look to another poignant symbol for humanity to emerge victorious from challenges. The lotus, the national flower of India, represents our history and culture and symbolizes spirituality, fruitfulness, wealth and knowledge. And that's the inspiration for India's G20 logo design. The design, rendered in saffron, white, green and blue, is drawn from the national flag of India. The seven petals in the logo signify the seven seas and the coming together of seven continents at G20 India 2023. Sitting above the lotus is a representation of the earth, reflecting India's pro-planet approach to life and seeing the world as one family. From this, we derive the theme for G20 India 2023, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, One Earth, One Family, One Future. A theme that brings the G20's focus on shared global growth, while being in harmony with nature. G20 India 2023. One Earth, One Family, One Future.
May I now request Dr. Ruth Lalnundanga to conduct the felicitation of the guest. Set the ball rolling, may I call upon the president of G20 MZU team, Professor Srinibas Pathi, to kindly give the welcome remarks and introduction of guests.
Very good morning to all of you. Esteemed Vice Chancellor, Mizoram University, Professor Pravakar Rath. Esteemed guest speaker, Ambassador Lalnundanga, Registrar Mizoram University, Prof. Lalnundanga, Mr. Ali Syed, representing RIS New Delhi, Dr. Bidhukanti Das, coordinator MZU G20 team, esteemed faculty, deans, heads, students, research scholars, guests, and dear friends. It's a great privilege on my part to stand before you to speak a few words about this meeting and introduce our esteemed guest to all of you. Friends, today Mizoram University celebrating G20 University Connect Lecture Meeting. This meeting is actually sponsored by Ministry of External Affairs, supported by Ministry of Education, Government of India, RIS New Delhi, the National Coordinating Agency. According to latest survey, our country has 1,113 universities. Out of these many universities, Government of India has selected 75 universities for this type of G20 University Connect Meet. And Mizoram University is among those 75 countries which is one of the pioneers in conducting such a meeting today. This meeting is in a blended mode. All of you who are here offline, in your presence, it is being held, and also it is telecast, webcast live for the audience in India and worldwide. And this, what would be the role of university in the context of G20 nations, our collaborations till now, and how we can take it further, like the theme motto of Mizoram University, greater deeds remain. So we will still search for greater deeds. And today, for this meeting, we have got guests, those who have come with the active sponsorship support of Government of India through RIS New Delhi. First, I would like to introduce to you our very own Honourable Vice Chancellor, Professor Pravakar Rath, himself a full-bed scholar, United States, one of the pioneers of library science education and profession in Northeast and in India. I welcome you, sir. I have with me Professor Lalnundanga, our energetic registrar, who is the guest of honor for 2 days meeting. I welcome you, sir. I have with us, Professor, all the guests who are here with us in the team, and Ambassador Lalnundanga Ralte, who I will after some time talk about him. He has a fantastic biodata spreading over 33 years of service in Indian Foreign Service, serving many of the countries here and also outside the country. And we have Mr. Olli Syed, who represents RIS New Delhi. I welcome Puralte and Mr. Ali, and with me, Dr. Bidhu Kanti Das, coordinator of the team. I also welcome Bidhu and all of you to this meeting. With these few words, I would like to speak a few of the achievements of Ambassador Lalnundanga Ralte. Interestingly, Mr. Ralte had his schooling and college education University in Odisha. He was a student of Stuart School, Bhubaneswar. He was a student of Ravensa College, Cuttack, which was established in year 1868. And he is a graduate of Utkal University, established in the year 1943. And mid-studies, he was selected for Indian Foreign Service. He joined, and for long 33 years, he has served in the Ministry of External Affairs, in many of the Indian missions abroad, including Hong Kong, Washington DC, Shanghai, Nairobi, Brunei, and Philippines. And he has been Ambassador Grade 1, representing our country in the international arena. He has been in many of the top institutes for further study during his career. He was with IIT Delhi, and he was also in Hong Kong learning Chinese language. And Puralte, after superannuation from Indian Foreign Service, was here in Mizoram, State Chief Information Commission for 5 years. And he is a person who has got wide experience in the field of G20 and foreign affairs. So Government of India has selected him to give a speech on India's G20 presidency. And after this inaugural one-hour session, which we will continue without any break, we have a technical session in which six of the faculty members, five from our own university and one from University of Tripura, they will talk on different designated subjects. So with these few words, I welcome all the guests, all of you, and wish this meeting will be a path-breaking session, after which throughout the year we will celebrate India's G20 presidency and also carry forward how we can get the best out of this presidency and get academic research collaborations worldwide. Thank you all.
It is with immense pleasure that I invite our esteemed guest, Ambassador Lalnundanga, Ralph, their former diplomat, Government of India, to give a special lecture.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Honourable Vice Chancellor of Mizoram University, Professor Pravakar Rath, Registrar MZU, Professor Lalnundanga, distinguished representative from MRIS, Mr. Ali, Professor Das, professors, students, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It's been quite a while since I stood on a podium to give a lecture like this. So if I falter a little bit sometimes, please do forgive me. Going back and reading the G20 papers brings back memories when I was in Kenya, years 2000 to 2004. Because by designation, I was also the deputy permanent representative of India to UNICEF and to UN Habitat. We were negotiating the Millennium Development Goals in the first instance. And so that those days and nights, I must add nights of negotiations, they really stay in memory. There were times when we were negotiating an item for almost 48 hours. Our chief negotiator would be from the joint secretary from the Ministry of Environment, and I would be with him. So we would take turns to go and have a shower. Otherwise, we were in the room like this, negotiating all the time, trying to make what each delegate was trying to say and what it meant for us. Like I was telling my colleagues from RIS, I have not been in touch since, Professor Pathi has said, I've been quite retired, and after retirement I've moved on to other things. So we are all aware that this year is the year of presidency for India. As you know, the presidency of most international organizations go by rotation or by election, depending on the institution and the way it's set up. G20 is set up to have its presidency rotate on an alphabetical basis. And interestingly, last year it was Indonesia, this year it's India, next is going to be South Africa, I think. Brazil, then South Africa. So it's 4 years that the presidency is going to be with a developing country. So that gives some impetus to the development goals of the South as we know it. In our time, when we were negotiating at the UN level, we used to use the G77 plus China. We termed ourselves the non-aligned group. So that was a grouping. But now this grouping of G20, as you all know, was formed in 1999 as a body to discuss common financial and economic issues. And it consisted of finance ministers and central bank governors following the Asian financial crisis. But as it grew, as it continued, and the 2007 financial, global economic and financial crisis happened, it was decided that this was a body that was quite active and quite possible to move forward. So it was elevated to the level of heads of governments. The result was that it expanded from just economic and financial to other forms of governance that are required to run a state. So it's now become quite a important body to discuss trade, sustainable development, health, agriculture, energy, environment, climate change, and anti-corruption. So G20 has continued to evolve, and what is good about it is that its membership is diverse, and it includes the world's leading economies, and also includes the more developed countries from the developing world, so that its discussions and decisions are more action-oriented, and not only just for its members, but also for the rest of the world. Now, with the formation of the head of state level, slowly all important international organizations, World Bank, IMF, UN, they have all been inducted as permanent invitees. So that has given G20 a bigger clout. And the importance of the G20 can be seen from the booklet that you have, where you can see that the G20 membership accounts for 85% of the global GDP, 75% of international trade, and they represent 2/3 of the world's population. As you all know, the most of the international in the international fora, the president or the chairperson becomes important as it takes the leading role in deciding the agenda of the next meets. So India's presidency is very important because it is an opportunity for us to present, to guide the agenda, and we can decide what are important to us and what we would like the world to discuss. So in for its part, Prime Minister has clearly stated that its leadership will be governed by India's view of the world as a whole unit. And we say it in our foreign discussions, one earth, one family, one future. That is the way we look at the world. It's taken from the Sanskrit ethos, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. So PM has stated that it will be India's goal that G20 will convey a strong message in favor of peace and harmony. One world, one one family. So, to this end, India sees its presidency as an opportunity to catalyze the international community to forge a more constructive and consensus-based solutions to the plethora of challenges the world faces in the area of global growth, stronger climate action, and robust health architecture. India will seek to use its influence to attain consensus on solutions for reviving global growth. Many people see India as sitting on the fence. We maintain friendship with Russia. We talk with the West. We deal with the West. We deal with Russia. But that is what every country does. It sees what is important to it. It sees what it needs. It sees what its people need for development. And it takes action accordingly. So today we are sitting in a position where we are talking to the West and we are doing good business with Russia. Because we don't want to make enemies of anybody, especially in our neighborhood. And in this situation of post-COVID, which has left millions in poverty, our view is that we need to move into a situation where solutions for reviving global growth, prime among which will be promoting food and nutrition, will be important. So for that, India has proposed LIFE, L-I-F-E, which stands for life for environment, to fast track a sustainable development goals and adopt eco-friendly sustainable lifestyles. One of the main focus of India's presidency will be to make digital architecture more inclusive so that it can be used as a catalyst for social transformation. To forward all this, some of the ideas that India has put forward are showcasing India as the mother of democracy. To this end, there are about 200 G20 related events in its presidency. Unlike in the past when we have hosted various international summits and we held them either in Delhi or Goa in one place, the government took the decision to showcase India. So these 200 meetings will be taking place in some 56 venues across India. As you all know, just last week, your own campus hosted the B20 part of the meeting. And what was most interesting was that the G20 allowed the local government to choose an area that is of importance to the local people, meaning local government, for the development of the state, and we all know what that subject was. So this is a good move, although we might think that we are not ready to receive foreign delegates in so many numbers. An effort was made and we did it. So it also pushed us beyond our borders. The most important aspect of this decision is that now G20 is no longer just a discussion among Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Environment, MEA, Ministry of Trade, Commerce in our case. It's now brought to a place like Mizoram, which is in the far corner of India, where not even our other Indian friends wish to come for a holiday. So we had all these people from all over the world flying in, and Unfortunately, I think our local government did not bring it out enough to the local population. I think we could have given it a bigger presentation to tell the people that this kind of a thing is happening here, it's happening for us. Now, people who come here are going to know about us. I think we could have given it more publicity, not just stopping people from parking on the streets, which actually you're not supposed to do anyway, whether G20 happens or not, and or covering up our pigsty. Why let the pigsty be there? People want to see how we live. If that's the way we live, why should we be afraid to show it? I mean, and cleaning your roadside. I mean, I do it. I sweep the area around my house every week. So I don't need a G20 to do that. So but of course, it spruced up the city. So I was very happy for that. And it made the roads drivable. Anyway, so the second area that we will be wanting to focus on will be energy transition. We all know that the biggest pollution is the production of energy. This very strong light that is burning on me is brought about by either burning some fossil fuel or something. So it has been identified as one of the main reasons for the depreciation of our environment. So accelerating low carbon growth is a key priority for India's ongoing renewables revolution. PM Modi presented a vision for inclusive energy transition at the 2021 COP26 meeting in Glasgow, where he introduced Panchamitra, or the five nectars, to which India is committed, some of which many of us will think are almost impossible. But it's a commitment that India has made. The most important thing is to make a commitment when it may not be possible. To make a commitment that is possible is fairly easy. But to make a commitment that is not looking so easy is a commitment. Otherwise, it's not a commitment. You just have to do it. So the commitments he made were that our non-fossil energy capacity will be 500 gigawatts by 2030. I don't know what is the present production rate, but it's not that great. And we have only 8 more years to reach that level. What is more easier to understand is that 50% of our energy will be from renewable sources by 2030. That's a very tall order. And we have only 8 more years to work on it. So all the mobile phones that we charge, the ACs that we run, all that will have to come from renewable sources. Our projected carbon emission is to be reduced by 1 million tons from now till 2030. And reduction of carbon intensity of its economy to less than 45% by 2030. And by 2070, India will achieve the target of net zero of fossil fuel. So everything, all energy requirements will be by renewable sources. Our colleague from RIS said Mizoram is a very prime candidate for sustainable development. I told him, yeah, because we don't have any industry. So if you don't have any industry, you don't have any need for energy. But if as we hope, our state develops, our energy requirements will increase massively. So you, as the leaders of tomorrow, the day after, and the day after, as students, you have to commit yourselves to these five things, that when you use energy, you will replace it. And as professors, you have to inculcate that into your students' development also. So it's a promise that Prime Minister Modi cannot do alone. It's a promise that every Indian citizen, whether we are living in an industry-less society of Mizoram or in the industrial heartland of Maharashtra or Chennai, we all have to do our part. So this concept of bringing G20 to the universities is something that I really support. And like I said, I've kept myself away from all these things for quite some time, but I accept it because I like the idea. So we spoke briefly about life. Before that I have to tell you about the solar, the International Solar Alliance. This was started even before I retired. And it faced much opposition. And at some point of time, we thought that we might not even be able to get it through. But finally, it was started with France, the ISA. And the main theme there is one sun, one world, one grid. So that is promoting renewable energy. And we now have 100 other countries as members in the ISA. I think in Mizoram also we have one or two solar parks. And I think we are an ideal candidate for solar parks, excepting for the monsoon season. So we should be able to generate quite a bit from the sun. So the next one is the third item is the lifestyle for environment. I think this is important for the youngsters. It was first proposed by PM Modi, as I said, at COP26 in Glasgow. Its aim is to urge the international community to promote lifestyle for environment as a mass movement towards mindful and deliberate utilization instead of mindless and destructive consumption. I think you'll be able to understand. Mindful and deliberate utilization. Use energy mindfully and deliberately. Don't just switch on all the lights in your house every night. Switch on the ones that you need deliberately. And you don't have to charge your phone unless it's really going in and down. So it is hoped that this will strengthen the spirit of the P3 model, which simply is the pro-planet people. So we invite all of you to become P3 people. And we hope that some aspects of India's tradition and culture, such as reuse, reduce, and recycle, will also help make people decide on making sustainable choices. But what I see today is that among our youngsters, if something is not working, they just throw it. And they ask their parents for a new one. It was not so when we were growing up. We were always looking for the repairman. The chair, I've got so many broken chairs even now at home, waiting for the time that I have to give it a leg or so. So we need to go back to that, reuse whatever you can reuse, reduce your requirements, and as far as possible, recycle. Single-use plastic, no. Use your plastic 2-3 times. If necessary, wash it. So the next one is the digital transformation, which during the post during the COVID and post COVID it has overtaken the world. We are very lucky in India that we have a big strength on the digital side. We all know that for over 2 years, our classrooms, our workplaces, and meeting rooms were here. Some not even on this, some on phones. We had stories of students who were sitting on top of the banyan or tamarind tree where they could get a better signal on their mobile phone so that they could attend classes. So we have been very lucky. We at least got some signal on a phone, or some of us had tablets or laptops to work on. Then even doctors, for fear of physical access, we didn't have physical access. Many of them we consulted on the phone. And what is the result of all this? Now digital payments have become so common even in a place like Mizoram. So now many of us don't carry wallets. We only carry our phones because you can GPay or you can scan and Paytm. India on this score is far ahead of other countries, including highly developed ones. India's digital transformation has meant that 80% of Indians out of the 1.3 crore have bank accounts. And what is more interesting is that out of the new bank accounts, 460 million of them were new accounts were processed through digital ID. So what has digitization done? It has made life so easy. Somebody puts an ad on the WhatsApp or whatever other chat group that you have. Oh, we have a fresh batch of carrots from so-and-so village, organic, cost this much. You want some? You say, okay, I want a kilo. So the seller will get a courier to deliver to your doorstep. And all you have to do is GPay or Paytm, no physical contact. You don't have to go. So life has become so easy because of digitization. And what is more important is that almost all of India's digital architecture is open source, open APIs, and open standards, which are interoperable and in the public domain, which makes them transparent and inclusive. Now, at the international level, citizens of most developing countries do not have any kind of digital identity. And only 50 countries in the world actually have digital payment systems. So we don't know how lucky we are to be a leader in that. So, and we all know how that has transformed and made our life so much easier. So the opportunity for bringing the benefits of this to the world is tremendous, and India sees this presidency as a key to achieving sustainable development goals on poverty, health, and most importantly, direct benefit transfer. So the money will not go through middlemen to the recipient, but can go directly to the person that is to get it. Now, the next subject is a bit more, item is a bit more tricky, where we want to work on, and this is climate financing. In order to accelerate green transition, what we talked about, bringing in sustainable energy instead of burning fossil fuels, we need finance, because without money, you cannot build the sustainable systems, and you need technology. Now, what the West has been telling us is that to develop that technology they have for green energy, it has cost them a lot of money. So therefore, if we want it, we have to pay. What we've been telling them is that, yeah, you built it, you researched it, but in the process, you also burnt up the ozone layer. So in our time, when we were negotiating, we had a phrase, common but differentiated responsibilities. So what is common? Common is the need to keep the environment safe. Common is the need for sustainable development. Common is the responsibility for the harmony and peace of future generations. But what is the differentiated responsibility? Baba, your industrial revolution, you have burnt up the ozone layer. You have made a big hole over there. So now what has resulted from that? Climate change. What has climate change done? In Mizoram, we usually have rains between Christmas and New Year. That same rain also happens in Chennai area. That is the northeast monsoon, which only Mizoram and the Chennai area receives. Have we received it this year? No. Climate change. What the British Industrial Revolution did in 1800s, that is what is affecting me now today. So, was that my responsibility that you burnt up the ozone layer? No, it was yours. So the differentiated responsibility. I will be responsible for what I do now. You were not responsible, so now you have to pay for what you have burned. So that's what we've been trying to tell the West, who are developed, who have money. If we look at the per capita incomes and what we eat in a year, they eat in a day. So they are more capable. So we keep telling them that they have high moral responsibility, and even now figures have been agreed on, $100 billion by so and so and things like that, but the West has never delivered. So it will be India's aim during its presidency to encourage developed countries to provide necessary financial, technology and capacity building support for mitigation and adaptation projects for the developing world. So it's a difficult subject, but we have to go into it. And the next item that India will bring out is the discussion on food security. So as we all know, post-COVID-19 and the international situation exacerbated by the Russian-Ukraine war has really disrupted world supply chains. Even countries that were supplying others are unable to supply. So it's become quite important that we restore the supply chains. And we feel, after feeding over 1.3 billion citizens and also giving out food aid to a few other developing countries, we have a good reason to try and help ensure adequate supplies of fertilizers and food grains to the world. So that will be one of our main issues, to promote natural farming, climate resilient and smart agriculture. One item that India wishes to introduce is millets, which are more robust and which are nutritious. We need to also move towards democratizing the global financial systems. So, like I said earlier, the Bretton Woods institutions, they really are not efficacious. And if we are to make them useful, we need to change their governance structures. So we will be championing the restructuring of the UN and IMF and World Bank, etc. Incidentally, the President Biden has recommended a friend of mine to head the World Bank, and I'm very happy that India has lent its support to Ajay Banga. We were together in Hong Kong, and for Mizos, it's interesting that when he first started his work after graduation, he used to come to Mizoram also, representing Nestle and selling Nestle. So he is not a stranger to Mizoram. We hope that with him at the REM, maybe we can see some changes in the World Bank also. Of course, the next item are the Sustainable Development Goals. Again, this have also been affected by the COVID-19 and the Russia-Ukraine situation, because whatever people were doing got disrupted for nearly 2.5 years. The SDGs, as incidentally, are also known as the UN Agenda 2030. So these are the goals that we want to achieve by 2030. And there are 17 of them. India would sees all these as an integral part of its development agenda. And we believe that achieving this will bring us into a better interconnected world. But what is important in attaining SDGs is that we have to take care of the least developed countries, and especially, and also the small island developing states. Because when I was ambassador in the Philippines, I was also responsible for a few islands in the Pacific. We visited them at least once a year each, some twice. Their lives are actually quite sustainable, but if they were to develop, there is nothing to sustain. They're sustainable because they are fishermen. They fish, they eat the fish, and that's about it. There's nothing further. So we would also want them to develop. So they also need money for finances for development, because fishing alone is not enough. They have certain ocean land which they cannot fish because they don't have the big ships. So Japanese and Taiwanese will pay them some money, build some buildings for them, and take away the fish from their area. So for them, there's nothing. So they also need to be taken care of. And it will be India's endeavor during its presidency to find ways to improve this SDG financing, and especially exchanging best practices, etc. You would have
the G20, the B20 meeting has been hosted here 2-3 days back. So for which, let me take an opportunity, this platform, as a registrar also on behalf of the whole, this is Mizoram University. So I thank all of you for your kind support and cooperation during this B20 meeting. And there is some, I have received one WhatsApp during those days, because especially our staff who has been working so hard for the preparatory of the B20 meeting, they keep on asking about among themselves that what is G20. So they could not get the right answer, maybe. So they used to ask the students in the department that what is G20? Even the students may not give the right answer to them. So one of the workshop that I have received, that they came into conclusion that what is G20 like, it may be a kind of a gospel concert. Because why they come into conclusion like the G may stand for the gospel. So 20 may stand for, people may come up with that and it may be like a G20. Why I'm highlighting this? Because this is the right step that the ministry has been taking up, the G20 University Connect. Because the main idea is that they would like to spread the G20 among the students as well, among the teachers. So that is why, so the RIS people are coming up to connect the university with G20. As we just heard from our guest speaker. So he has been pointed out the different issues, the priorities of the G20, as he has rightly pointed out that when we talk about the sustainable development, he has focused on the renewable energy, and he has focused on the climate change and the food security. So apart from that, what is important is the financial stability for the development. So as VCSR has pointed out just now, why the university needs to be connected with G20? Because one earth, one family, one future. So we are very much responsible for this sustainable development. Because even in the B20 also, we have been discussing, though it is a business meeting, so is there any role to be played as an academician or the university? Yes, very much it is. Because when we discuss about the issues, we need to connect with the G20 priorities with the university. Because in every field of development, we are responsible doing what kind of a sustainable development to be initiated through a research base. So that is why we can contribute, like what our guest speaker has spoken about, like the renewable energy, very much related with academic, very much related with the research. The climate change, it is going on. We are doing research on climate change. We are identifying the indicators. So these are the issues and what we can contribute. So don't take it as a problems that we are facing. As a professor, as a student, as a researcher, all these things, if we could take it as a challenge so that we can overcome and we can give a solution. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. To conclude the first part of our program, the inaugural session, let us now acknowledge the talents of our winners for elocution and on-the-spot essay writing competition. May I request Dr. Elizabeth to kindly come forward to hand out the prizes for on-the-spot essay writing competition. May I request our Honourable Vice Chancellor, Professor Pravakar Rath. Sir, to kindly hand out the prizes.
The Mizoram University G20 University Connects essay competition was held, and then I am going to declare the result of that competition. The word goes to the winner is Mr. Alokesh Goga Padaya of Department of Horticulture, Aromatic and Medical Science Plant, Mizoram University. Please come forward. And then the first runner-up is also, then second runner-up, as well as Constellation Prize. Thank you, congratulations. Sir, please, sir. The first runner-up is Mr. Lomsang Pierralte, Department of Sociology, Mizoram University. Second runner-up goes to Mr. Bijit Sharma, Department of Electrical Engineering, Mizoram University. Mr. Bijit. Another third place, Mr. Lalbiak Zwala, Department of Public Administration, Mizoram University. May I have Dr. Bidu Kantidas to hand over? Thank you. And then another consolation prize goes to Mr. Anush of Department of Mass Communication and Ms. K. Malsom Kluangi, Department of Mass Communication. They both can come together. Yes. Yes. Mr. Anush of Department of Mass Communication, and Ms. K. Malsom Kluangi, Department of Mass Communication. Yes. Please come here. Congratulations to all. And then another competition was elocution. Elocution competition engaging the young minds was held. The winner of the elocution competition is Mr. Lomsang Pierralte, Department of Sociology. Okay. Ms. Van Lal Chan Choi, Department of Botany. Ms. Van Lal Chan Choi, Department of Botany. Okay. Please. Yes.
Okay.
again upstairs.
Ms. Rosan Pui, Department of Public Administration. And then here is one consolation prize that goes to Mr. Saurav Upadhyaya, Department of English, Mizoram University. Thank you so much for absentees. They could collect it, their certificate and prizes from the organizing team. Thank you.
The session is to be followed by the technical session. Before that, we will have the presidential remarks from Professor Srinibas Pathi.
Thank you, esteemed guests and dear friends. What is the takeaway or way forward from this meeting? I have two important points. Number one, documentation. We will publish in a monograph, in a proceedings form, all these six speeches, short speeches we are going to listen to in the next session, and that of Poor Alte. This is number one. And number two, I propose from this podium that we should have sustainability of G20 University Connect. In the whole country, 75 universities are going to have it, but what next? Beyond the pomp and ceremony of such meetings, beyond 2023, let us have a national nodal center, G20 University Research Center, and the center will be, I propose, at RIS New Delhi. Let's hope and pray it comes up. RIS New Delhi becomes the nodal center. Then I propose five regional centers with justification. Who are they? Ahmedabad, the place which speaks of universal humanism and peace from the west. Chandigarh in north, which has the state capitals of two states and one UT with all sorts of best academic infrastructure. Coming to northeast, I propose Aizawl, Mizoram University in particular, the beautiful state which has international boundary and the gateway to east and southeast Asia, Aizawl in northeast. East, I propose Bhubaneswar, the upcoming India's academic and skill capital with a global skill development center. And south, I propose digital capital of India, Bengaluru, having the highest number of institutions of higher learning in the country, maybe in the world, one of the best in the world. So these five as the regional centers, and rest 75 university be the cutting edge local centers. If you can do it, that will be the best takeaway way forward of this meeting. With these few words, I thank honorable guests and request them that let them be here in the first row, and we will have our guests of the next session, which continue just now. And there are very short speeches by our esteemed learned speakers, professors, and within 1 hour, we'll complete everything. Thank you so much, sir. I request Dr. Lalton Pui to usher those teachers, professors to the dais. Please tell their names. Thank you.
May we please have Professor Vanil Thorna, Finance Officer, Mizoram University, on the dais. Professor HKLL Din Pui Fente, Director, International Affairs, Mizoram University, please. Professor KV Reddy, Head, Department of Political Science. Professor Loknath Mishra, Head, Department of Education, and Professor Lalni Loma, Head, EENRD, and Nodal Officer, New Education Policy 2020, Mizoram University. May I also request Dr. Jayanta Chaudhary from Netra. I now hand over the program to the president of the G20 Mizoram University team.
Okay. Let us start with the first talk by Professor Bhalna Chana, Finance Officer of Mizoram University, who is Professor of Economics also, Financing Higher Education, G20 Best Practices.
A very good afternoon to you all. Very profusely, I would like to offer my gratefulness to the Mizoram University G20 Connecting Team for giving me this opportunity to have a lecture on, as we have just heard, Financing Higher Education, G20 Best Practices. The theme is really relevant to understand the performance and the working of higher education system in G20 countries. However, due to time constraint, I may not be able to dwell upon in detail the financing of higher education in all G20 countries. I would be focusing only on 6 countries. That is Australia, Canada, China, India, South Korea, and USA. By way of introduction, let me start by saying that higher education plays a crucial role in the transformation of society. Skilled manpower, the backbone of the economy, is provided by higher education. Because of the powerful impact higher education has on the economy and social life of the people, society across the world are investing huge resources in the field of higher education. Higher education financing involves a political and social decision-making process through which public revenue and other resources are collected and allocated to finance higher educational institution. Both public and private sectors are funding higher education. Public funding comes from the central government, provincial or state government, and local governments, while private financing comes from households, endowments, philanthropic sectors. Higher education financing is politically a tricky issue and a very sensitive issue any democratic countries since 1990s. Due to fiscal constraint, public fund for higher education has been substantially reduced. Meanwhile, universities, irrespective of whether a country is democracy or totalitarian, they are being encouraged to mobilize private resources. Accordingly, several alternative sources are being explored and experimented. Due to public fund constraints and explosion of demand for higher education, the funding system of higher education has undergone rapid change and transformation. In this lecture, as I have already informed you, I'm giving you an overview of the changing profile of the system of financing higher education in Australia, Canada, China, India, South Korea, and USA. Let me start with the financing of higher education in Australia. Australian higher education system comprised of public university with a very small number of private universities and other higher education service providers. Australian government is the main funder and regulator of the system. Almost 50% funding come from federal and state government. In 1989, the Australian government introduced an income contingent loan scheme for the payment of higher education tuition charges. Loan is repaid through the income tax system. At the time of introduction of this scheme, it was the first of its kind in the world. According to experts in the field of higher education financing, income contingent loan, income contingent student loan scheme is regarded as the most equitable and most effective financing instrument, as debts are repaid only when and if students afford to do so. Now coming to Canada. Canada is among the most developed countries in the world, especially with respect to the Human Development Index. 62% of the population in the appropriate age group are enrolled in higher education, while 53% of its economically active population have university degree. The provinces are responsible for funding higher education. As per the Constitution of Canada, universities' income mainly comprise of provincial grants, tuition and others, such as income from investment, sale of services, etc. Canada is offering a very well-funded student financial aid package consisting of grants, scholarships, and student loans. Under Canada Education Saving Grants, families are given incentives to save money for their children to attend higher education. Governments complements the savings of the household according to the annual income of the family. This is a very, very appreciable scheme. Study grants and scholarship are also available under Canadian Student Grants Program, while student loans are provided under Canada Student Loans Program. Now coming to China. Chinese government invested a significant share of its education budget to higher education sector. There is a clear trend of declining role of public finance and more reliance on private financing from the 1990s. The university revenues had become much more diversified in China. Tuition and other fees had been increased significantly over the years. Chinese government expanded its student aid system since the mid-1980s. It provides several kinds of financial aids for needy students at the graduate level. Now, I am coming to the financing of higher education in India. India has one of the largest educational systems in the world. Both public and private higher educational institutions are operating in the country. Center and state governments are responsible in financing higher education. The financing system comprises of grants, tuition, and other fees, including scholarship. Student loans are also available from public sector undertaking banks, not from the government. Private higher educational institutions play a significant role in the massification of higher education in India. 80% of higher education institutions belong to private establishment. The growth rate of private establishment outpaced public university. Private institutions are running self-financing courses in professional education such as engineering, management, and medical institution. Now coming to the financing of higher education in South Korea. South Korea is economically and educationally a developed country. The higher education system in South Korea consists of national university, public universities, and private universities. National universities are set up and run by the Korean government. Public universities are set up and run by local authorities, while private universities are run and managed by the incorporated educational institutions. National universities receive more than 60% of its revenue from government sources, while student fees contributed roughly 30%. Private universities receive 69% of their income from tuition fees, while government grant provided 12% of the revenue. Private expenditure accounted a significant portion in financing of higher education in South Korea. It is more than 90% of the total expenditure in the higher education is accounted by private expenditure. Now coming to the last but not the least countries, that is the United States of America. America's higher education system is among the best in the world. However, most educational policy in USA is decided by state and local governments. Federal government plays a limited role due to the 10th Amendment of the Constitution. The American higher education, like any other country, consists of public and private universities. Public universities come under state government, while private universities are governed by private board of trustees. In contrast to many nations, all public and private institutions charge tuition. State government are the largest source of revenue for public universities, while tuition fees are the largest source of revenue for private institutions. Financial aid package in terms of loans, grants, and scholarship are widely available to the American students. Grants are available in most cases a need-based, while scholarships are often tend to be merit-based. Finally, the U.S. government has several student loan programs, the most important being the so-called Stanford loan. These loans may be direct student loans from the federal government, or they may be guaranteed student loans from private banks for which the government guarantees repayment. Stanford loans may also be subsidized or unsubsidized. A subsidized loan is awarded on the basis of the financial needs of the student, while subsidized loans are charged with interest. With that, I come to the end of my lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I request our guest, Dr. Jayant Chowdhury, representing Netra, Guwahati, and from Tripura University. Dr. Chowdhury, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am standing here on behalf of National Standing Committee on G20 University Connect program. Being one of the members for that, I was assigned to be here. G20, as you are well aware, that it was started in 1999, and now we got the opportunity to represent India in the global level. There are many more things related to G20. Already you are experienced about the B20 happened to your university, and also our honorable keynote speaker, Dr. Rath, already discussed about those things. Basically, if you talk about the G20, this thing, there are many more activities which are called working group. And those working group includes agriculture, anti-corruption, culture, digital economy, disaster risk management, development, education, employment, environment and climate change, energy transition, health, trade and investment, and also the tourism. There are many other part, as I said, pa, you know that B20 here, there are many more like Civil 20, which is called C20, is a civil society organizations and other, and Startup 20, Think Tank 20, Urban 20, Women 20, Youth 20, so many more things are there. So all together in different places in our country is being represented. From the Netro Foundation, as I already mentioned, that one of the knowledge funder for the Northeastern states, first we conducted in the IIT Guwahati, the first program, and then here, and next 15th of March, Rajiv Gandhi University, 28th of March, we have been in the Dibrugarh University, and the April, month of April, for another program will be conducted in the Northeastern states. And as it is mentioned that engaging youth or young mind. Last couple of years, we are working with RIS. RIS, you know that Research and Information System for Developing Countries, which is a think tank for the Ministry of External Affairs, dealing with various activities, various think policies, not only G20, but BIMSTEC and ASEAN Center. And also there is Forum for India Development Cooperation, which you know that Forum for India Development Cooperation is that how India is going to cooperate with the developing countries. Particularly you have seen that during the COVID situation, how India has helped for the COVID vaccination and health facilities to different countries, including African countries and other. Even the construction of, or the reconstruction of, the before Taliban take this Afghanistan, India has presented and made several billion dollars for investment of the Afghanistan for rebuilding there. So as a whole, India's development cooperation continues in different way. Until number of students are coming from different countries to with the scholarship in India. So development cooperation is a part of India's very from the very beginning. And I'm very proud that I am one of the board of directors for the Forum for India Development Cooperation in the RIS. And apart from that, last year we started that localization of SDGs. We have conducted 9 programs with RIS on localization of SDGs. So as a global goal, how it can be part of the local areas. So similarly, in the G20, there are many more things. The main area, how the youth can be engaged in this G20, the main area is how you have to identify the local issues. As I mentioned, all these things as a working group, starting from agriculture to investment, starting for the climate change, trade and investment, and tourism. So all these sections are there. You can take your as a master thesis, or you can take your PhD thesis also on the various area. And how this G20 you can link with your not only working, but also your academic area. Even last year, we conducted one program for young scholar for the Northeastern states in RISLE, where the Planning Commission, chairman of the Planning Commission also came, and also our Honourable Ministry of State, Dr. Ranjan Kumar Singh, he also presented there. And we have identified 16 young scholars from Northeastern state who are doing their PhD in various topics related to on their part. But we try to link how this is their PhD topic can be linked with the SDGs. So this way, this G20 issue also, until unless it will be, as it was mentioning by Professor Pathi, that after this program, what will happen? Similarly, it may be the question after this event, what will happen? B20 already completed in this Mizoram University. Similarly, the G20 event today, it will be completed. But no, this is the initiative. So first, it has started. I will request all the professors here, the faculties here, and also the young scholar, please try to identify those areas. You can visit to the G20 website. You can see that what are the working groups are there. And try to link your thesis or research in this area. Then you can make a big contribution to the path of G20. Because next year again, that it will continue. And already it was discussed in the national body that G20 standing committee, national steering committee, it will continue for the other countries also. So always we are trying to this from the RIS point of view. And also Netro is invited to anchor the Northeastern states. If the faculties and the young scholar, if you would like to involve with us, we have a RIS Netro Young Scholar Forum. Already 257 young scholars already joined with us. And we have RIS Netro Academic Forum, where number of teachers are involved. If you are, would like to also contribute. And from April month onward, after completion of this G20 series, we are going to make all these topics, either working group topic, as well as that Sherpa group. You know that there are a number of Sherpa groups. So if you would like to be in the online event, please, I will welcome all of you on behalf of RIS and on behalf of Netra. And I will try to all of you, because that young people, they are the torch bearer. So what we are doing right now, maybe something, but in the next generation, in terms of climate change, in terms of anything for the prosperity of the Northeastern states, you please try to contribute. Yesterday, we are coming here and we are discussing that this stage was something different. But suddenly, all the young students here, and this is a scholar from various departments, they made this entire thing as a not only clean, as a such a beautiful thing. So young mind can do a lot of things, not we. So it is humble request to all of you, please join us in the development of the Northeastern region. You contribute by your own way, you contribute your, and the professors and academic, whoever present here, will request all of you, this is not the end, this is the beginning. Let's bring and present our India to the global, then we will be the Vishwa Guru and we will be the number one country in the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Chaudhary. We have amidst us one Fulbright scholar in Princeton University, USA, Director, International Affairs, Mizoram University, Professor H.K. Lalnundanga Fente. She will talk about scope for the prospects of international student exchanges among G20 nations.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I thank the G20 MZU University Connect team for having given me this opportunity to speak in this program, Engaging Young Minds Lecture Series. Since I am a teacher and I like to talk, and very used to talking for hours on end, I have prepared a 10-minute speech so that I don't go on and on. So, young minds, please be engaged. I will speak no more than 10 minutes. One Earth, One Family, One Future. The G20 theme this year reflects India's desire to promote universal sense of oneness during its presidency. This theme aptly aligns with an important new thrust under the National Education Policy 2020 that is being implemented across the universities in the country, that is, the internationalization of higher educational institutions, which envisions attaining the highest global standards in the quality of higher education that directly refers to our topic today, prospects of international student exchanges among the G20 nations. Now, Professor Tona, our finance officer, had already spoken to you at least about five nations funding at the federal level and at the state level for their internationalization. And so therefore, I'm not going to speak on specific countries. I will also be giving you the overall picture. So therefore, in line with the NEP 2020 and the G20 theme, concerted efforts by all the stakeholders of education, that is you, the students yourselves, your parents, the staff, the educators like us, who are also learners, the policy makers, and the community at large is expected, quote unquote, the NEP 2020, to make our young generation of learners truly global citizens with deeply rooted pride in being Indian, which would also help to realize Vasudeva Kutumbakam, our G20 theme inspired by the Maha Upanishad, the old Sanskrit scripture. Indeed, proud we are of our Indian-ness, our Indian heritage, but are we ready for it? For this international student exchanges among G20 nations, some are the most developed countries in the world, as we had already learned. What are our prospects as students? Of course, most of the G20 nations are well equipped and prepared systemically and organizationally for the internationalization of higher education at home and across borders, as these happen at home and, of course, across borders, and execute academic and organizational strategies, keeping in view the economic, social, and academic impacts of such exchanges. The others are striving towards that just as we are, because we need to see and be prepared about all of this to execute academic and organizational strategies at home and abroad and be prepared systemically and organizationally. So let us look into the a little bit of details about what internationalization of higher education is, because it is through this that we do the international student exchange programs. So the main components of internationalization of higher education are enrollment of international students, development of international branch campuses, exchange programs for students, staff, and scholars, internationalization of the curriculum. That is so important that we are being engaged in most of the universities in the country, and research and education partnerships between institutions regionally and internationally. So internationalization, therefore, could be in terms of semester exchange, joint or dual degrees, and twinning programs that is being made possible by the NEP 2020 pertaining to internationalization of our curriculum, especially. Many Indian Institute of Technology, Indian Institute of Management, and some universities in the country have gone much ahead, which is being followed suit by other universities and colleges. You will be able to hear a whole lot of success stories on social media as well. Please do browse. And you can browse all the G20 nations and what has been happening in terms of the exchanges of students. Now, these should help in producing, therefore, global citizens who are knowledgeable and culturally sensitive cross-culturally in this globalist world. To address the needs for this internationalization process, the Ministry of Education through the University Grants Commission has mandated that offices for international affairs be set up in Indian universities to coordinate all matters relating to international students, facilitating research, teaching collaborations, and faculty-student exchanges with high-quality foreign institutions, and signing of MOUs with foreign countries for mutual benefit, of course, considering the ranking and accreditation, just like we have here our NAC accreditation, the NIRF ranking, QS World Ranking, so on and so forth. The structural policy reforms brought out by the NEP 2020 advocates horizontal and vertical linkages of foreign education institutions with Indian universities, at the same time promote the Indian value-based education system through the export of education by allowing the opening of campuses of Indian universities
to promote our cultural
heritage.
Ancient knowledge system, the Indian system of medicine,
Veda, naturopathy, yoga for mental health, etc. The new policy would increase the number of inbound students from other countries to India and retain outbound students in India by providing affordable 2018, which has been renamed as the Office for International Affairs, that which I have been given the opportunity to head at this moment. That is why I am here speaking in front of you. The office provides a single point contact for carrying out all collaborative activities with foreign educational institutions. International students are given admission into undergraduate, postgraduate, research, and professional courses of Mizoram University through the Office for International Affairs. Students from different countries like Sudan, we have them here in this room, Japan, Namibia, Ecuador, our neighboring countries like Bangladesh, Myanmar, Nepal, have already been studying in various departments for various courses, leading to bachelor's, master's, and doctorate degrees, and research students from the USA, the United Kingdom, other European Union and Asian countries have been hosted under this endeavor. Expanding experience and knowledge through collaborations and exchange programs to realize the vision of NEP 2020 in its internalization fervor is apt at this opportune moment during India's G20 presidency this year, 2023. Mizoram has seen an exponential surge in local innovations and products during the last few years, especially post-COVID. These products, though marketed locally, still need honing through more exposure and exchanges at the international global level in our incubation centers in order to turn them into a sustainable and thriving business. Student exchanges opportunities among the G20 nations in scientific cross-cultural research endeavors, as already driven home the point by our own registrar, Professor Lalnundanga. Scientific cross-cultural research endeavors will go a long way in facilitating collaboration and globalizing local innovations and products to realize the theme of G20 India's presidency, One Earth, One Family, One Future. Our fervent hope today is now to grow in the right direction towards more exchanges of students across the borders. As we always say in Mizoram University, greater deeds remain for realizing Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Thank you so much.
Thank you. While thanking Professor Femte, I request our international student to stand up in their seat. Let us give them a huge applause. Dear students, international student, please stand up. They are amongst us. Welcome to Mizoram University. Please sit down. Thank you. Please sit down. Now, it's a pleasure to invite Professor K.V. Reddy, Head Department of Political Science, a very sincere researcher. And during COVID time, almost every 1 month, 2 months, we get one scholar of Professor Reddy. So he has been given the topic, scope for collaborative research among G20s. Professor Reddy, please.
Thank you, sir. Fellow participants. So as part of G20 MZU Connect Lecture Series, I've got this opportunity. Thanks for the team and giving it to me, a very pertinent topic, because you all know we're all students of university. Unlike colleges, universities are meant for research and research promotion. So it's the right place to discuss about the topic that has been given to me a couple of days ago. When he was giving me this topic, he said it is the most safe topic because I do not have the experience like my predecessors in the respective fields. I'm a student of politics, and yet I try to put across a few arguments, points before you within the short time limit of 10 minutes. As somebody said some time ago, yes, we're all teachers. We know speaking hours and hours. But yet, time restraints we should keep in mind and then understand the platform on which I have to speak. This, of course, there is a lot of scope for collaborative research among G20 nations. It is an exploratory study I've done based on my little research within a couple of days. So I would like to point out, there are about 10 points based on my paper. I've jotted down a few points. Due to passage of time, I'll focus on these points only. If I distract, maybe my time may not be sufficient. Now, as far as G20 is concerned, you're all aware that a lot has been discussed already so far today and a few days before. But yet our registrar was telling today that most of us are unaware of what this G20 is all about. And he was giving a different meaning. And it is surprising because when we are in universities, if we do not have proper awareness, despite the fact that it is no more a recent phenomenon. G20 is there for the past two decades or so, and yet we do not know, means proper knowledge has not been shared about this. This is very relevant to all of us. Now, I don't have to tell on G20. There's so many brochures that have been brought about, already circulated. They speak volumes on that. Now, what I would like to discuss, of course, Indian presidency, this year it's on rotational basis. Therefore, Mizoram University has been involved. Definitely, it's a prestigious moment for all of us, and we are very active. Wish there had been many more students. Though there is no class suspension, we are unable to have many students here. Perhaps they would have also listened to the programs like this. Now, of these 10 points, I start one by one. First, research is not about inventions and discoveries alone. It's rather, it's about sharing of our inputs, sharing of information among institutions, individuals at various places. And the purpose of all this is to solve problems. Problems may be related to society, polity, economy, culture, whatever. So problem solving is the main focus of all research. And therefore, this research collaboration is very much essential to all the individuals present here in MZU. And you all know that ICR, International Collaborative Research, is a multi-purpose exercise. There are many positive aspects of it. I may not discuss all that, but in the wake of globalization, you all know as to how ICRs, International Collaborative Researchers, have been encouraged within India and outside too. But you know, the benefits of these ICRs with the globalization are varied. Where different countries have different benefits. For example, the advanced capitalist countries have got lots of benefits at the cost of third world countries like us, India. So, but yet, it is about better connectivity among nations in terms of various groupings. So G20 is one such group which certainly contribute to advance the knowledge research through these ICRs. Now, the second point that I want to focus is about COVID pandemic. You know how COVID pandemic has affected all of us, particularly in higher education and research, more than other sectors of development, because it's a generational disturbance, generational activity. If health is damaged, you may recover, but a couple of generations have been, you know, affected by this COVID pandemic. We were all helpless except doing online activity. That was neither satisfactory to students nor to teachers, but then we had to do that, and so did it. Now, the pandemic implications are far-reaching, I don't have to tell, at home and abroad. It's a universal phenomena for over 2 years. So, however, pandemic has also raised the awareness level about the need of collaboration and networking among various countries and institutions like these. Therefore, there's a dire need of collaborative research for problem solving and advancing knowledge. In the third point, it's about our students and education. And Madam has already pointed out as to how maybe my follower, Professor Loknath Mishra, may touch upon higher education or education as such. Already there are several students from India who are going abroad, who are pursuing their higher education and research studies. Of course, they are affordable, but then there are many unaffordable students and researchers for whom G connectivity perhaps may help a little bit. And as a result of this G20 connectivity, the prospects have been enhanced for research and collaboration like this. Now, besides addressing the challenges of global economic crisis, as was that is the main theme of this G20 perhaps, but then G20 also focuses on other important challenges, for example, in the field of health, education, employment, through short-term and long-term strategies. So the fourth is about G20 initiatives, rather institutional opportunities as to how G20 has put across before us RIIG, that's about Research and Innovation Initiative Group, and Development Working Group, Educational Working Group, Employment Working Group. These institutions are helpful as far as promoting advancing research is concerned. So, and then there are G20 resolutions, commitments
you know, for the past 20 years it is there. There are already more than 15 summits have been conducted. As part of these, there were several commitments being made, but yet the implementation is still incomplete. Perhaps in the post-COVID era, Indian government, since it has undertaken the presidency now, may focus on it, and the challenges like economic crisis, Ukraine-Russia war, natural calamities, climate change, terrorist violence, SDGs, these can be taken up by the government of India. And this, thanks to Indian presidency, the pending projects may be undertaken. And sixth, as far as international collaborative research is concerned, they can promote, one, teamwork across borders, networking with researchers and institutions, multidisciplinary and multinational collaborations, bilateral and multilateral agreements, motivational research, financial and otherwise towards problem solving and all. So as far as seventh, we have this ICS have certain challenges too, for example, time consuming, travel restrictions, visa permit issues, lacking coordination for meeting of partners because partners are spread across the globe, and slow paperwork due to bureaucratic and petty issues, demotivation when funding and grants are delayed, political climate, you know, when regime changes, the changes take place at different levels. Eighth, funding is the main issue. You know, 83% of university side, the lack of funding as the main problem for research conduct. So in fact, funding is plenty. As a matter of fact, it is available in several countries, but the point is we need to identify as to where and how this funding can be trapped. Now, as far as the ninth is concerned, as I said, Indian government has certain initiatives at home and abroad, funding and otherwise, institutional. For example, there is a national ICT portal that will focus on the skill and job opportunities for the youth, and then there is SPARC, and then ICSSR, you all know, ICRIER, and there are several scientific research institutions like ICMR, DBT, DST, CSIR, and you know what UGC all about. It is also promoting research in different arena. Now coming to the last point, 10th, foreign opportunities. There are several countries in the G20, but since I was asked to identify, I have identified Germany from Europe, Australia, Canada from North America, China from Asia, and Brazil. So with this, I think I should conclude within a short span of time as to how Indian presidency can provide better opportunities for ACRs, and ultimately, research is something that has to be focused towards problem solving and advancing knowledge. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Professor Reddy. Now, I request one of our lead scholars in USA, former director, Faculty Development Center, head, Department of Education, Professor Loknath Mishra. He will talk about sharing of learning resources and educational excellence among G20 nations.
Honorable Chairman, Professor Srinibas Pathi, Chairman MZU G20 University Connect team, and delegates on the dais, my colleagues, and the student friends. My topic is learning resources and educational excellence among G20 countries. Being an educationist, I will talk about what is the objective of this lecture and what is the learning outcome of this lecture. First of all, my objective is to sensitize what are the learning resources among the G20 countries. Then I will highlight about the learning outcomes. My lecture I will divide into six parts. First, what is learning? Then types and sources of learning resources. How it will bring excellence in education. The fourth point is my experience at USA. Fifth point is some best learning resources among G20 countries. And sixth is India's initiative for educational excellence. First of all, I will start from Mahabharata. Learning is a never-ending process. It starts from mother's womb. I am giving the example of that Abhimanyu. In Mahabharata, the great epic of mythology, we can say that in Mahabharata, the Abhimanyu starts the learning from the mother's womb. So learning is a never-ending process, and access to learning, resources and educational excellency are essential components of high-quality education system. And countries that invest in these areas are more likely to achieve positive educational outcomes. While some G20 countries have invested heavily in education and achieved impressive results, others struggle to provide a basic level of education to their citizens. Coming to ensure the success of future generations, it is essential that all G20 countries continue to prioritize education and invest in learning resources and programs that promote academic excellence. Due to advancement of technology, the whole world is shrinking to global village now. India has one of the largest education system in the world, with more than 1113 universities, 45,000 degree colleges, 13 lakh schools, 10 million teachers, 370 million of learners. India has always promoted educational collaboration in the world. In our country, an extensive network of public libraries, which provide students with access to vast array of books, periodicals, journals, and other reference materials, which is very similar to Australia and Canada. Government of India introduces National Education Policy, NEP 2020, a philosophical document, is based on fundamental principle of access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability. In this policy, importance has been given to access to learning resources. Knowledge generated from the learning resources, which include textbooks, libraries, internet connectivity, computers, and other form of technology, leads to the quality education. While talking to India, India has developed excellent digital educational content, which are available on various platforms like Diksha, the digital infrastructure for knowledge sharing. Swayam, NEPTEL, Virtual Labs, EPG Patsala, and National Digital Library. There are many learners who do not have adequate access to digital means of education. To address the issue, Government of India uses TV channel Swayam Prabha, a 24/7 channels, a group of 34 DTH channels, and a radio including community radio also. With the help of these, we have succeeded in providing education in 24/7 to learners in the remote areas. The learning of videos, many videos, in this connection, I want to highlight the National Resource Center for Educational Research of Mizoram University has also developed 40 videos, which is available in the MOOC platform of Swayam. So during my, I will share my, some of my experience. During my US visit, I have visited 10 universities. Out of 10 universities, the Pennsylvania University, University of Penn, and Cabrini University, Drexel University, Widener University, they have started learning resource centers for different learners. Different type of learners, for undergraduate learners, vocational education learners, or postgraduate learners, they have their own learning centers. In University of Pennsylvania, they also started the SAIL, S-A-I-L, that is Structured Active In-Class Learning. So this is a very good platform, that is the SAIL, is a very good platform to for the learners and for the teachers also. Teacher will not teach, he will act as a facilitator. In this platform, teacher will not teach. Nowadays, the constructivist approach came. That's why the teacher will not teach in the classroom. He will act as a facilitator. So in regard to this SAIL, I would like to highlight SAIL classrooms typically have students seated at tables, working in groups with instructors, circulating and guiding the process of teacher, and teacher will act as a facilitator. Similarly, I will share some of my experience while I am in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia's Madrasi Learning Management System is a digital content repository that enables several e-learning models, blended distance learning and face-to-face technology-enhanced learning. Also in Argentina, Conector Euclidit, is a platform, provide a digital platform with open educational resources created collaboratively by all the countries, jurisdictions, as well as a system of virtual classroom to enable teachers to prepare their classes online. Australia's Digital Technology Hub and the Learning Potential app provide learning resources and services of teachers, students, parents, and supports remote and online learning for the experiencing and economic social disadvantages. The Republic of Korea also integrated digital platform for teaching and learning, provides an online and offline educational environment and helps students to actively cope up with rapidly changing environment. Similarly, in United Arab Emirates, Madrasa program is there. So 11 millions of, with this Madrasa programs, 5,000 free Arabic videos and general science, mathematics, biology, chemistry, physics, public science, public administration, political science, history, geography, as well as other subjects, 11 millions of words of educational contents they have developed. So in this 21st century, they have also included the 21st century skills. So many G20 countries are expanding learning data system to improve the educational management, monitoring, and evaluations. Policies aims to create adequate and continuous learning opportunities, equip teachers with appropriate instructional materials, and offer attractive career pathways, opportunities for promotions. In one of my papers, I highlighted the ATL, anytime learning system. Just like ATM machine, it is anytime learning system. Anytime learning system, I got it from Russia. So anytime learning system, you put the card in just the machines and you browse your resources and you learn. So ATL is there. And with the vision of Honourable Prime Minister of India, digital universities are going to be established, which will provide access to students across the country for world-class quality universal education with personalized learning experience at their doorsteps. If the digital university will come, the many students will benefit from these digital universities. With the vision of India's National Education Policy 2020 and adaptation of 21st century skills, we will make us Vishwaguru. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Mishra. We have, I'm sure, someone who has got his PhD from Philippines, Professor and Head, Department of External Education, Rural Development, and Nodal Officer, NEP, Professor Ali Noma. He will talk about synergy between NEP 2020 and Vision G20. Last but not least.
Mr. Chairman, sir, thank you very much for this opportunity. I think we need to do a little stretch up. After sitting for hours, some of us are feeling dizzy already. Can we have a little stretch up, please? Okay, this is the last lecture, so it should not be long. Right. Yes. Thank you very much. As our chairman has pointed out, my topic is synergy between NEP 2020 and the vision of G20. At this point of time, I would like to start my lecture by saying, India commences the G20 presidency. As we have heard from the previous speakers, the keynote speaker, the theme of this G20 is One Earth, One Family, One Future. What do we mean by this? For me, the way I understand the One Earth, the One Family, the One Future is this. We have only one Earth. Only one Earth. So living in that single Earth, we should be family members, right? But why we are fighting each other? Why we are competing each other? That is the question we need to answer today. So, the G20 presidency of India is aiming all of us to bring together into one family and shape our future as one future. The whole future generation will live in a peaceful world. Essentially, the theme affirms also the value of all life, as our keynote speaker pointed out. Human, animal, plant and microorganism and their interconnectedness on the planet Earth and the wider universe. The theme also spotlights life, L-I-V-E, life, lifestyle for environment, leading to the global transformative actions result in a cleaner, greener, and bluer future. National Education Policy 2020, the aim is developing good, thoughtful, well-rounded, and creative individuals by enabling them to develop their character, ethical and constitutional values, intellectual curiosity, scientific temper, creativity, and the spirit of service. In summing up, the National Education Policy 2020 aims at producing good human being. When we say good human being, what does it mean? What comes into our mind? Good human being. Not only educated person, but it is creating the whole human being, right? As individual, our NEP 2020 is aiming to create a good human being, to produce a good human being. And global citizen. As individual, you can be good citizen of India. But we have to think of creating not only a good citizen of India, we have to think of a global citizen. That is the aim of our NEP 2020. On taking over the G20 presidency, our Honourable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji pointed out the following, I quote, "Today, the greatest challenge we face, climate change, terrorism, pandemics, can be solved not by fighting each other, but by acting together." I continue to quote, "To heal our planet, we will encourage sustainable and environment-friendly lifestyles based on India's tradition of trusteeship towards nature." I continue to quote, "Today we have the means to produce enough to meeting the basic needs of all people in the world, but not for our greed." Let us remember, today we have the means to produce enough to meet our basic needs, not for our greed. Today, we do not need to fight for our survival. Why we need to fight for our survival? Survival of the fittest, right? We are running after each other. Survival of the fittest. Our era need not be one of war. Indeed, it must not be one, unquote. India's G20 presidency is not a mere event. It imbibes the concept of creating global citizens and is a fundamental to developing the world order. It is about working together to create a cleaner, healthier, peaceful, technological competent, yet sustainably developed world. And our education and skill ecosystem has a vital role in this. The National Education Policy 2020 is based on the foundational principles of 1, access, 2, equity, 3, affordability, 4, accountability, and these are India's guiding lights for achieving the shared visions of G20.
Here, if you go through the curriculum framework, curriculum and credit framework of the UG program, which was released by UGC in December 2022, you will find the graduate attributes. The aim is not to produce the one who is very much expert in his specialization only. As we said, it is to produce the whole human being. So, in addition to whatever knowledge we learn from our disciplinary specialization, we are aiming at producing a human who has these graduate attributes. I'll just point out some of these. Creativity. While learning your discipline, you have to be creative. Communication skills, you have to be well-versed in dealing with other people because you are not alone in this earth. Analytical and reasoning, thinking, that attribute has to be there. Research-related skills, coordinating, collaborating with others, this is very important. Collaborating and coordinating with others. Leadership readiness, you are there to lead the country in the near future. You have to be trained to be good leaders during the time you are in college, you are in university. Multicultural competence and inclusive spirit. It's not selfishness, it's inclusive spirit. Value inculcation. That human values, universal human values have to be inculcated in a human person, a human being. Autonomy, responsibility, and accountability. Environmental awareness. Awareness is not enough. Here, I will add the word action. You are aware of the environmental issues, but without action, what you will do? So, the graduate attribute is trying to bring a human being into the one who is aware of environment issues and act upon it. Community engagement. A sense of service. You may be earning a PhD degree. You may be having a PhD degree. But if you don't have a sense of service, you are nowhere in this earth, as we are one family, right? So I would like to quote a song sung by Michael Jackson, which was released in 1991. Just the chorus, the beginning of the chorus, I'll just quote. Heal the world, make it a better place. For you, for me, and the entire human race. Why Michael Jackson has sung this song? Our earth, our global earth, needs healing. Heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. In conclusion, I would like to invite all of us, not only those who are here inside the auditorium, us in the sense of the whole India, the whole earth, I want to invite all of us to join hands together to make this G20 presidency one of healing, harmony, and hope, as well as, or as we all are one earth, we all are of one earth, one family, one future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. So I think now this is time for question and answer. So dear students, scholars, if you have brief queries, opinion, suggestion, there are a few cordless microphones. You can pick one of them and be there. Tell your name, department, and you can speak. If any specific guest is to be addressed, you talk about him or her, and then they can respond to that. Please be brief. We have only 5 to 10 minutes time to wind up? Anyone can start.
Yes. You raise your hand so that the usher will give you the microphone. Anyone?
Or do we take that you have accepted all these speeches and understood everything? Healing, hope, and harmony. Is it so? Okay. If that is the resolution, let me invite Dr. Bidukanti Das, coordinator MZU G20 University Connect team, to propose a formal vote of thanks. Dr. Bidu.
Good afternoon to all the dignitaries in the dais and off dais too, and all the faculty member, research scholar and students. It's my great pleasure to offer vote of thanks on behalf of Mizoram University and G20 University Connect team. First of all, I would like to thank our chief guest, Professor Prabhakar Rath, Honourable Vice Chancellor, Mizoram University, for facilitating everything by his office, as well as being here as a chief guest for our program. Then I would like to thank Ambassador Lalnundanga, former diplomat, Government of India, kindly accepted our request to be one of the speakers on G20. So thank you, sir. I would like to thank Professor Lalnundanga, Registrar, Mizoram University, for all the facility provided as well as guest of honor here. Then I would like to thank Professor Srinibas Pathi, senior most professor in the university as well as in all India in public administration department, for nicely conducting the program, instructing us to do the program a success. So thank you, sir. I would like to thank RIS, that is Research and Information System for Developing Countries, New Delhi, for sponsoring the program here in Mizoram University. And special thanks to Professor Sachin Chaturvedi, Director General of RIS, for his keen interest in Northeast India and our Mizoram University, for selecting as one of the premier university for 75 universities selected in All India for G20 Connect team. Also, I would like to thank Dr. Priyadashi Dash and Dr. Ali Shahid and their office, who coordinated with us for successfully conducting the program. And as well as Ali Sayed, he reached yesterday only, which was finalized Saturday night. So we were not able to include his name, as well as NETRA representative, that is Dr. Jayant Chaudhary. He also finalized his program only on Saturday night, and they came yesterday. So we are very sorry that their name was not included in the program distributed to you all. Okay. Next, I would like to thank Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, that is for the same reason selecting Mizoram University as one of the premier university for G20 University Connect program. I would like to thank NETRA Foundation, Guwahati, as a knowledge partner of the program. I would like to thank all the officers and staff of Mizoram University, especially VC office, Register office, Finance office, that they facilitated us that within a quick time, as well as that time B20 meeting was going on, that every facility they provided and we were able to conduct this program after three consecutive holidays, that is Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Also, Chapcharkut, okay, so important, okay. So next, I would like to thank all our resource person who accepted our request and delivered a lecture here. That is Professor Banlal Chona, Finance Officer, Mizoram University, Professor H.K. Laldenpui Fente, Director, International Affairs, Mizoram University, Professor K.V. Reddy, Head, Department of Political Science, Mizoram University, Professor Luknath Mishra, Head, Department of Education, Mizoram University, Professor Lalni Loma, Head, Extension Education and Rural Development, Mizoram University, as well as Nodal Officer of NEP 2020. Also, Dr. Jayanta Chaudhary, Head Rural Development, Tripura University, as well as he is the representative of NETRA. Next, I would like to thank all the deans, heads, all faculty members, research scholars, students, member of organizing committee G20, media, press for covering the event, all MZU officers and staff, especially health center, engineering cell, ICT center, PR office, and usherer. Without their help, program was impossible. Last but not least, those all who are behind the success of this program, but not mention their name here. Okay, lots of us backstage who are doing this, okay, even for a telecasting program live on YouTube, all of them, okay, I'm thanking all of them because without their help, it was not possible. Thank you all for attending the program and made the event a great success. Thank you all. And one more announcement. All of us, please stand up for national anthem.
Thank you all. Teachers, guests, and members of OOB organizing committee, they should come backstage. And all dear students, scholars outside, you have a small refreshment. Thank you all.